It's 1972, and police are frustrated as a killer is murdering female college students and completely evading their detection. Meanwhile, one man, who would normally stand out in a crowd of thousands, is flying under the radar, completely undetected. At 6 feet, 9 inches, and 285 pounds, Ed Kemper is impossible to miss. But he's been befriending off-duty police officers at a bar near the courthouse, getting as much inside information on the case as he can. With his near-genius level IQ, he is gaming the entire charade.
They'd buy me a beer, I'd buy them a beer. Casual relationships, but I was poking around a little bit trying to find some things out. I knew they wouldn't be privy to hot information, but there were some things that were bothering me, like were there any speculations on how they were dying?
How did you get the knowledge to outsmart the police?
Watching television, believe it or not. Joseph Wambaugh, police story. Got some tremendous insights into not just the gimmicks, the actual things, the tidbits that you would pick up from their procedures, but the mechanics behind that, the logic behind it, was I would not allow myself to walk into even a potential trap of behavior. And one of those was talking about those crimes too much to people, initiating conversations about that.
There was a memorial service for two of the victims.
Yes.
Were you tempted to go?
Yes.
But?
I'd seen one too many episodes of one too many crime shows where that is one of the available resources for clues.
Welcome back to Crime A to Z, where we detail cases and criminals from their very beginning until well after other reporting ends. Today we'll be talking about one of the most gruesome serial killer cases in American history, the case of the co-ed killer. With an IQ at near genius level, serial killer Ed Kemper was able to outsmart police and tragically, his victims, at every single turn. His unassuming personality would be so enchanting that even a call into police to confess his murders would lead to them sending him away in disbelief. Santa Cruz, California was traditionally a quiet beach town complete with surfers and retirees. At least until 1965, the year the University of Santa Cruz was built. With residents suddenly spilling over from relatively nearby San Francisco, the college turned the town from a peaceful, quiet retirement community into more of a bustling, youthful, loose and free-spirited city, similar to its hippie, Berkeley, California counterpart. So all was fine in the city until 1972. Suddenly, girls began to go missing and body parts began to wash ashore. Someone was killing young female or co-ed hitchhikers, and the community wondered whether the fairly recent change in its residential makeup was to blame. The media quickly dubbed the elusive killer the co-ed butcher. On December 18, 1948, Edmund Emil Kemper III was born in Burbank, California, to two very disciplinarian parents, Cornell Kemper and Edmund Kemper II. He was the only son and the middle child. While Kemper looked up to his father, he resented his harshly punitive and verbally abusive mother. His parents would divorce when the younger Ed was 9 years old, after which, Cornell moved away with Ed and his two sisters. At an early age, Kemper began showing classic signs of serial killer pathology, including torturing insects and animals, and performing rituals with his sister's dolls, which resulted in severing their heads and hands. He remembered how, as a small boy, he used to slip out of his house, go to his second grade teacher's house, and armed with his father's bayonet, observe her through the windows. In later interviews, he admitted that gas chamber and electric chair were some of his favorite games to play when he was a child. At age 10, Kemper buried a pet cat alive, dug it up, severed its head, and placed it on a spike. Kemper admitted in a later interview that he enjoyed lying to his family about murdering the cat. Then a few years later, when he was 13, he murdered another family cat because he thought it favored his sister over him. He preserved separated parts of the cat's remains in his closet until his mother discovered them. On one occasion, when Kemper's older sister teased him about why he would not try to kiss his teacher, he responded, "If I kiss her, I have to kill her first." As the years passed, Kemper grew bigger and stronger, which was not surprising given that his mother was 6 feet and his father 6'8". But Kemper's bizarre behavior also grew and became more concerning. As a result, his mother used to lock him in the basement for the night out of fear that he might sexually abuse his sisters. Kemper was locked underground in complete darkness, with the trap door on the floor covered by the kitchen table to ensure he could not escape. Kemper was terrified and traumatized. And it was those nights in the darkness where he allowed his hatred of women to fester and grow. When Kemper was 14, he ran away from home to reconcile with his father. There he learned that his father had remarried and had a stepson. Kemper stayed with his father for a short while, but within a few months, his father sent him away to live with his paternal grandparents in North Fork, California. Kemper was devastated. He hated living in North Fork. He described his grandfather as senile and said that his grandmother constantly emasculated his grandfather and himself. At age 15, after he'd been living with his grandparents for 10 months, Kemper and his grandmother, Maud Kemper, were arguing at the kitchen table. Kemper was furious and raced off to recover a hunting weapon that had been taken away from him because he was shooting animals pointlessly. He returned to the kitchen and shot and killed his grandmother. Then, when his grandfather returned from shopping for groceries, Kemper went outside and shot him in the driveway next to his car, killing him. Not knowing what to do next, he called his mother, who told him to contact the local police and turn himself in. After being apprehended, Kemper simply said that he wanted to experience what it felt like to kill Grandma, the most common quote associated with Kemper. Kemper later testified that he killed his grandfather to prevent him from suffering once he found out his wife was dead. Following the murders, court psychiatrists briefly diagnosed Kemper with paranoid schizophrenia. As a result, he was committed to Atascadero State Hospital, an all-male maximum security facility that houses mentally ill convicts. With a population of over 1,600 patients, several dozen who had committed murder, and 800 mentally disordered sex offenders, it was more than the 10-person team of psychiatrists could handle. And ultimately, and tragically, the institutionalization of Kemper at the facility ended up exposing him to extreme deviant behavior and making him far more dangerous than he was before he was there. He would later recall, "I found myself a minor in a psychiatric hospital for hardened criminals. According to the law, I should have been sent to an institution with minimal security, but the judge was so outraged by my crimes that he declared, I'm not wanting to send this young man to Disneyland. That's why I ended up in Atascadero with people on average 20 years older than me. Believe me, I grew up very quickly." And Kemper would do more than just grow up at Atascadero. He was extremely smart and bright. His IQ clocked in at a near genius level, somewhere between 136 and 145, both of which rank in the top 2% of scoring. And he was also incredibly friendly and extremely likable. All of these aspects resulted in him becoming a trusted assistant to the psychology staff, with access to the detailed files of murderers and sex offenders, including detailed accounts of how they carried out their crimes and the tactics they used to get away with them. In his role, the then 15-year-old Kemper would hear firsthand highly graphic details of violent rapists, and he began to have his own violent sexual fantasies. And he also noted how most of the rapists had been caught because they were identified by their victims. So he concluded that his best chance at being successful as an assailant was to make sure he didn't leave any victims alive. Also, since he had access to psychological tests, he knew exactly what psychologists were looking for when they diagnosed patients. So he learned how to pass any tests at will. He had actually memorized the exact responses to 28 separate assessments. So, while Kemper was originally diagnosed with paranoid schizophrenia upon admission, psychiatrists and social workers at Atascadero re-diagnosed him with a personality trait disturbance. Then, after 5 years at Atascadero, the now gigantic, 6'9", 285-pound Kemper was granted parole and released from the psychiatric facility on December 18, 1969, which was his 21st birthday. He was released to a halfway house along with a recommendation from the hospital that Kemper not be allowed to return to his mother, as it could trigger more violence. But once he was released, there was little to no oversight or management. And without any means of support or assistance, Kemper returned to live with his mother. Once he was staying with his mother again, Kemper's relationship with her became even more toxic than before. The two often had arguments, which the neighbors usually overheard. Kemper later said, "My mother and I started on horrendous battles, just horrible battles, violent and vicious. I've never been in such a vicious verbal battle with anyone. They would go to fists with a man, but this was my mother." Kemper relocated to Alameda to live with a friend after getting a job at the Division of Highways and accumulating enough cash. But that only gave him little relief from his mother, who still frequently called and visited unannounced. And since he often struggled with money, Kemper would end up having to return to his mother's apartment frequently. Kemper would also be involved in two motorcycle accidents, one of which rendered his left arm broken, for which he'd received a $15,000 settlement and used it to purchase a yellow Ford Galaxy. And with that car, he began to practice. Back in the early 70s, hitchhiking was not uncommon among college students on the West Coast, and Kemper would pick up numerous young female hitchhikers over and over and over again as he fantasized what he could do to them and fine-tuned his strategies. He'd deliver each of them safely to their destination, noting which of his actions was the most effective for gaining the women's trust. Kemper would later discuss these practice runs, sharing that it all started because of his inability to communicate with women.
My inability to communicate socially, sexually, I wasn't impotent, but emotionally I was impotent. I was scared to death of failing in male-female relationships. I knew absolutely nothing about that whole area, even if just sitting down and talking with the young lady. I need to be able to really communicate, and ironically enough, that's why I began picking people up.
He performed these practice runs for more than a year, fine-tuning his strategy, until May 1972. The early 1970s in Santa Cruz was already a terrifying time for residents. John Lindley Frazier, a Charles Manson-like murderer who killed a Santa Cruz family of five, had just recently been convicted and sentenced. And another serial killer, Herbert Mullen, was about to begin terrorizing the city just months after Kemper would begin his killings. So between the three of them, the small California town was about to begin a streak of killings that would help it earn the title of Murder Capital of the World. On May 7, 1972, Ed Kemper would put his long-awaited plans into action, picking up Mary Ann Pichet and Anita Mary Lucchesa, two 18-year-old Fresno State University students who were hitchhiking. He was supposed to be driving them from Berkeley to Stanford University. But after an hour's drive, he arrived at a remote woodland location close to Alameda that he was familiar with. There, he killed Pichet, then Lucchesa. Kemper then put both women's bodies in his Ford Galaxy's trunk and began driving back to his apartment. And he was nearly caught when he was stopped on his way by a police officer for having a broken taillight. Kemper remained calm and polite and was just issued a warning. But he would later confess that the stop excited him. And had the police officer decided to check Kemper's trunk, Kemper said he would have instantly killed him. Pichet's skull would later be discovered on Loma Prieta Mountain in August of that year. Despite a thorough search, no more of Pichet's remains, nor any signs of Lucchesa, were ever found. Kemper would later comment on how his first murder was bumbling, and how he should have been caught.
I thought I was pretty slick, and went and tripped all over myself that first two murders. The first 24 hours, there were three clear times I should have been busted, and I wasn't. Because three different individuals or three different groups of people got scared and minded their own business and looked the other way.
Kemper's next victim was Aiko Ku, a 15-year-old dance student who was hitchhiking to a dance class after she missed her bus. Kemper would pick her up and strangle her. The day after Kemper murdered Ku, he was due before a panel of psychiatrists for a follow-up parole requirement. Kemper told them what he knew they wanted to hear, and the two doctors on the panel concluded that there was no reason to consider Kemper a threat to anyone. They congratulated each other on having rehabilitated a killer child, and both of them recommended that Kemper's juvenile record be expunged to give him a better shot at becoming a better citizen. The judge disagreed with sealing Kemper's record, but didn't have any grounds to fight it. Kemper delighted in both the secret charade as well as his ability to pull off such a feat. Just one day after murdering Ku, he drove away with a clean bill of health and a criminal record, wiped clean. Kemper would lay low for a while, reveling in and fantasizing about his past murders. He continued picking up hitchhikers, releasing them, and learning. But as the fighting with his mother continued and escalated, the strong urge to kill returned. And on January 7, 1973, Kemper, now living with his mother again, picked up 18-year-old student Cindy Shaw while driving around the Cabrillo College campus. He would shoot and kill her. By this point, police had connected the co-ed killings to each other. As a result, they increased the bus schedule and strongly warned the students against hitchhiking. Also, students had been warned to only accept rides from cars with university stickers. But since Kemper's mother worked at the college, he was able to get such a sticker himself. Then, one month later, February 5th, Kemper had another argument with his mother, after which he stormed out of his house in search of possible victims. On campus, he came across students Allison Liu, 20 years old, and Rosalind Thorpe, 23. Once they entered his car, he shot and killed them both. Kemper had no preference for how he murdered his victims, whether it be strangling, shooting, stabbing, or smothering. His only consistency was the treatment of their corpses, where his MO included necrophilia, rape, and other horrific violations. Kemper would later confess that performing such acts with his victims' corpses allowed him the ultimate control of his victims, and that he relished having the corpses all to himself. He would freely discuss during later interviews what may have started his need to dismember bodies, as well as what was going through his mind after he would do so.
I could put it on an incident. I mean, my father chopping the heads off of our two pet chickens and my mother insisting that I eat them for dinner. you know, we could say it was something that simple. I don't think it was. Now, my dad heads out back with a hatchet. I got on my bike and I rode. I tried to stop it. I remember that. I got on the bike, rode around the block. I was crying. I haven't talked about that for a lot of years. I'm sure that may have implemented something, that may have gotten something rolling, but along fantasy lines. But it took a lot of years of development along those lines to really get off.
A couple of months after the murder of Allison Liu, a records clerk at the police department was inspecting the bill of sale for a particular firearm. She noticed that the purchaser's criminal record, which was officially expunged, could be faintly seen through the blackout marks. She could make out that the person was previously involved in a murder in another county north of Santa Cruz. The man attempting to buy the firearm was Ed Kemper. By this time, Kemper was well-known and well-liked by local police, as he would regularly hang out with the off-duty officers after work at a local bar called the Jury Room. Like he'd done with so many psychiatrists, prison staff, and other professionals before them, Kemper came off to the officers as personable, likable, and seemingly as harmless as they come. Big Ed, as they'd refer to him, would spend hours discussing guns, ammunition, and other topics of interest with the officers. Although Kemper was friendly with police, none of the officers were interested in being the one who would have to confiscate the gun from the towering Big Ed. The most junior of the detectives of the sheriff's department, Michael Alufi, would end up being tasked with confiscating the gun from Kemper, who was not at all considered a suspect in the disappearances at the time. Alufi and his partner drove to Kemper's home on a quiet suburban street just before Kemper was arriving home. They informed him that they needed to retrieve his gun to make sure he was authorized to have it. And without incident, Kemper opened his trunk and allowed the officers to retrieve the gun bundled in a towel. Alufi noticed that the trunk, oddly, had absolutely nothing in it. No liner, just a bare trunk. But he didn't think much of it. They returned to the station, turned the gun in, and thought nothing further of it. Having taken the lives of his grandparents and six young women without suspicion, Kemper was about to embark on the murder he dreamed of since he was 8 years old.
It was springtime. It was April. for 2 months I hadn't killed. And I said, it's not going to happen to any more girls. It's got to stay between me and my mother. And it's got to, I can't get away from her. We're still fighting. She's still belittling me. She's still, I'm like a puppet on a string. And I entertain her. She knows all my buttons. And I dance like a puppet with that pain. And it had even gotten physical. So here I pick up these two young ladies in Berkeley on Ashby Avenue. Petite little dolls. I want to see how together I am, if I can resist this temptation.
The girls ask Kemper if he's going in their direction.
And they get in my car. They want to go one way. I know they need to go the other. If they go the way they're insisting on, we're headed right back out to where the first two co-eds were murdered. And I'm saying to myself, oh my God, all I got to do is relax and they'll take me to their death. I've got the gun in the car, the same one I've been doing it with. I insisted. As gently as I could, I took them where they needed to go, to their college.
The girls got out of the car and thanked Kemper.
That was 1 week before I murdered my mother. I said, she's got to die, and I've got to die, or girls like that are going to die. And that's when I decided I'm going to murder my mother.
On April 20th, 1973, after returning from a party, Kemper's mother, now 52, awakened her son when she arrived home.
And she went out to a party, she got soused, she came home, went to sleep. I was woken up by that, came out. I walked up to her bed. She's laying there reading a paperback, as many thousands of nights before. And she said, oh, I suppose you're gonna wanna sit up all night and talk now. I looked at her, I said, no. I said, good night. And I knew I was gonna kill her, you know? And I'm so cold, it's so hard. And that's the first time in 10 years I've looked at it that way. I mean, that intensely, that honestly. It hurts.
Ben, he waited for her to nod off, crept back into her room, and stabbed and beat her to death.
And what's her closing words? I suppose you want to sit up all night and talk. God, I wish I had.
Then, fearing that his mother's best friend, Sarah Hallett, would soon discover his mother's body, he invited Sarah over for dinner. She was delighted. She arrived, and Kemper strangled her to death as well. Kemper placed both bodies in a closet and fled the area. Taking caffeine pills to keep awake for the more than 1,500-mile drive, he drove nonstop to Pueblo, Colorado. After driving for 3 days without sleeping, Kemper arrived in Pueblo, but couldn't find any news about the killings of his mother or her friend on the radio. But still suspecting police had discovered their bodies and were likely onto him, Kemper found a phone booth and began to make a call. Two weeks after Detective Alufi visited Kemper to retrieve the towel-wrapped gun from his bare trunk, the Santa Cruz Police Department received a phone call at 5 a.m. in the morning. It was Ed Kemper, freely admitting to killing his mother and her friend. But the officer taking the call didn't take the big Ed that they used to hang out with at the jury room seriously. He advised Kemper to contact them later. Kemper did, but again was met with disbelief and assumed to be a prank. Kemper called yet again and urged them to send Detective Alufi, who had recently been to his mother's home to confiscate his weapon, to return there to check and confirm his story. Kemper also confessed to killing the 6 co-ed students. Then he waited for the police to come and arrest him. Police rushed to the home of Kemper's mother and found the home undisturbed. There was no indication of the murder until they turned over his mother's mattress and found it soaked in blood. Nearby was a cryptic note left by Kemper, which read, "Not sloppy and incomplete, gents. Just a lack of time. I got things to do. Approximately 5:15 a.m. Saturday. No need for her to suffer anymore at the hands of this horrible, murderous butcher. It was quick, asleep, the way I wanted it." Ed Kemper was taken into custody. Thrilled by the notoriety of being a serial killer, Once Kemper was apprehended, he began compulsively confessing. He provided long and detailed confessions that seemed unending to officers. He delighted in detailing to anyone who would listen the crimes he committed, in chilling and graphic detail. Crimes so pathological, the officers were left disturbed. And with Kemper's arrest, police finally discovered why the co-ed killer had eluded them for so long. As he was hanging out with police at the jury room, Kemper was observing their strategies relating to his case, and gleaning how they planned to identify and catch him. That inside information gave him an upper hand in eluding them.
They'd buy me a beer, I'd buy them a beer. Casual relationships, but I was poking around a little bit trying to find some things out. I knew they wouldn't be privy to hot information, but there were some things that were bothering me, like were there any speculations on how they were dying.
Did the cops like you?
Like I said, a friendly nuisance. I got in the way, and it was deliberate. Again, friendly nuisances are dismissed.
Why did Kemper kill? Experts have concluded that all of Kemper's earlier killings were simply a symbolic rehearsal for killing his mother. And once he'd accomplished killing her, he no longer needed to kill, and that's why he turned himself in. Kemper, on the other hand, claims his motives were different. When asked in an interview why he turned himself in, he claimed he sensed the police had found him out when Sergeant Alufi came to confiscate his gun. He figured they were playing a game of cat and mouse with him, and that they were fully aware he was the murderer. And so, to spare his mother the embarrassment of learning that he was the co-ed butcher, he claims he killed her, similar to what he stated in the cryptic note that he left. In a separate interview, however, Kemper claimed that the reason he turned himself in was that the original purpose was gone. It wasn't serving any physical, real, or emotional purpose. It was just a waste of time. Emotionally, I couldn't handle it much longer. I just said to hell with it and called it all off. On May 7, 1973, Kemper was charged with 8 counts of first-degree murder. After learning of his detailed and exhaustive confession, Kemper's defense team had no defense options other than to plead not guilty by reason of insanity. Kemper's trial began on October 23, 1973. 3 psychiatrists selected by the court deemed Kemper to be legally sane. On November 8th, after just 5 hours of deliberation, the jury of 6 men and 6 women found Kemper guilty on all 8 counts of first-degree murder. Prior to sentencing, the judge asked Kemper what he thought his punishment should be. That was an easy question for Kemper, since he'd been dreaming about this moment since childhood. His response to the judge was that he felt that he should be tortured to death. But since there was a moratorium on capital punishment in California, Ed Kemper was sentenced to 8 life sentences to be served concurrently. Edmund Kemper is serving out his prison term at the California Medical Facility State Prison at Vacaville, north of San Francisco. Not surprisingly, given Kemper's apparently likable personality wherever he goes, Kemper has been considered a model prisoner. And, ironically, given his crimes, he makes guards, prison staff, and inmates alike feel comfortable in his presence. At one point, he was in charge of scheduling inmates' appointments with psychiatrists. And he was also the coordinator of a project called the Blind Project, a nonprofit project to help blind inmates. Kemper voiced over 5,000 hours of narration for the project, resulting in hundreds of audiobooks. Since he's been in prison, Kemper has granted, and no doubt delighted in, numerous in-depth interviews for documentaries and other productions covering his life and crimes. He's also been the subject of multiple books, movies, television miniseries, and even songs. He was the inspiration for the character of Buffalo Bill in the 1988 novel Silence of the Lambs, and a number of others. And several songs have even been released that feature quotes or excerpts from his vast library of interviews. Kemper has also worked extensively with the FBI. In the 1970s, the FBI began a project where they would visit serial killers in prison to help them understand and identify them. Kemper was one of those killers. As a result of interviews during that era, FBI agents were able to identify some common serial killer characteristics and backgrounds that we had not known until that point. including that they typically tortured animals as children. In one interview with Kemper, reporter Robert Ressler recalled a terrifying encounter that occurred during his third interview with Kemper at Vacaville Prison. Ressler had already had two previous visits with Kemper, where he was accompanied by at least one other person. But on this third visit, Ressler felt that he had established a rapport with Kemper, so he decided to interview him alone. They spoke in a tiny locked cell near death row for 4 hours. Then, once they concluded their talk, Ressler pressed a very audible buzzer to summon a guard to come let him out. But no one came, so Ressler continued to talk. After a few minutes passed, Ressler pressed the buzzer again. No response. A full 15 minutes later, when there was still no appearance from the guard, Ressler pressed the buzzer again. Still, no response. Ressler tried to remain as calm-looking and unconcerned about the lack of response as he possibly could. But Kemper quickly picked up on his reaction and commented, "Relax, they're changing the shift, feeding the guys in the secure area." Kemper then smiled and stood up, re-revealing his enormous size to Ressler. Then he added, "Might be 15, 20 minutes before they come and get you." Ressler panicked, but tried not to show it. Kemper continued, "If I went in here, you'd be in a lot of trouble, wouldn't you? I could screw your head off and place it on the table to greet the guard." Realizing that Kemper was completely correct, Ressler tried to fill what seemed like an eternity with talking and bluffing. He told Kemper that he'd be in deep trouble if he messed with him. Kemper responded, "What could they do? Cut off my TV privileges?" Ressler threatened long-term solitary confinement. But Kemper shrugged the threat off and reasoned that whatever period of solitary he would get would pale in comparison to the prestige he gained in prison from killing an FBI agent. Ressler was now in full-on panic mode, but he tried to remain composed. He reflected on how dumb he'd been to decide to interview Kemper alone, suddenly realizing that he'd fallen victim to Stockholm Syndrome, where victims begin to identify with their captors, then trust them as a result. Despite having been the chief instructor for hostage scenarios, Ressler found that he had fallen victim to the very condition that he taught others to look out for. His mind raced to determine his next move. He decided to continue the number one strategy for hostage scenarios: talk. So he said to Kemper, "Surely, you don't think I'd come in here without some method of defending myself, do you?" Kemper replied, "Don't shit me, Ressler. They wouldn't let you up here with any weapons on you." He was right, of course. Ressler verbally sparred back and forth with Kemper to both buy time and allow himself to regain his composure. And then finally, a guard arrived. From then on, it became FBI policy to never allow an agent to interview a convicted killer, rapist, or child molester alone. In 2015, 42 years into his sentence, Kemper suffered a stroke. This brought his volunteer efforts with the Blind Project to an end, and resulted in him being declared mentally disabled. In 2019, he was said to be, at least partially, confined to a wheelchair, doesn't bathe, and has essentially given up on life. He's generally in very poor health, suffering from diabetes, heart problems, and other ailments. Kemper was first eligible for parole in 1979. His parole would be denied that year, as well as in subsequent hearings every year until 1982. Between 1985 and 2017, Kemper would come up for 9 more parole hearings, 4 of which he waived his right to, and the remaining 5 of which resulted in his parole being denied. At his 1988 hearing, once he was denied, Kemper stated, "Society is not ready in any shape or form for me. I can't fault them for that." And at his 2007 denial, the prosecutor stated, "We don't care how much of a model prisoner he is because of the enormity of his crimes." Kemper's next eligible parole date will be in 2024, at which time he'll be 76 years old. Aside from the heinousness of this case, one finding that sticks with us the most is a statement by Kemper that seems to be common among serial killers and general criminals alike, similar to Josef Fritzl, who recommended checking the basements of other fathers. And that is that for every one of them that's caught, there are many, many of them that are not.
"Well, I'm not an expert. I'm not an authority. I'm someone who has been a murderer for almost 20 years.
Can you say how many people might be doing crimes like you were doing?
It would be a guess, but it's not. It's far more than 35. It isn't that impossible in this society. It happens.
Are there more people?
They didn't give up.
How
many? She didn't give up. I did. I came in out of the cold. And what I'm saying is there are some people who prefer it in the cold.
In the end, the question that many have is the classic one of nature versus nurture. Was Ed Kemper born to kill, or did his upbringing, environment, and experiences groom him to kill? The ongoing debate among scientists, criminologists, and psychologists is which one plays the larger role in the making of a serial killer, genetics or environment. But what experts do agree on is that Kemper is a classic sociopath. Everything's all about him. He feels no guilt. He has no compassion whatsoever. But what of that? Was he born a sociopath? Is it his fault that he's that way? It's a contentious debate. We want to hear what you think. But before you comment, we'll leave you with one statement from Kemper himself, where he shared, "I need to believe that something in me is salvageable." So, what are your thoughts? Was he born that way? Or do you think that if he had not been exposed to the gruesome and brutal crime details at Atascadero, that his murders would have stopped there? Or maybe, if he had not returned to living with his mother? We hope this video did justice to all the victims of Ed Kemper's heinousness. Please share your thoughts in the comments. And if you like this video, please do us a favor and hit the like button to help us grow. And hit subscribe so you never miss a single video.